Very welcome, everyone. This is the last meeting of the this series of open meetings, so we make best use of this meeting. But before we begin, I feel something very important. I want to share my feeling for. It is also end of Goa season today, 2018 and 19. So I very deeply feel grateful, thankful to the team who worked so much actually to make it happen. Team means the core team, which is common team in Pune and here also, and also the new members of the team, volunteers also. They helped us, and because of that, online friends like you could join consistently, and you could get a good. Best possible quality of audio and video actually, because if you have been to Arambol and if you have ever struggled with internet, then you know how it is here. Checking a email is one thing, but actually delivering a video and audio is something very different, no? So I'm thankful on behalf of online friends also like this. So thank you everyone. And the team and the volunteers, thank you so much. I have nothing which I can share in return to all of you except my love. And I pray to my masters, to Lord, that anything that is beautiful in me be shared with all of you. It is not that I am trying to compensate, but it is that I am feeling thankful. Also, actually, I want to thank some of the Sangha members, those who have been with me for quite some time, and they have been financially supporting us by going out of way and like this. They have been contributing much more than their contribution of focus group or any retreat for that matter. And I just want to share this with you, all of you. And I know all of you who contribute don't like your names to be you know, spoken, so I will not say your names who are already right now present here and online. I just want to share how I feel about it. I feel from my side it feels like a God's hand. It feels like life's support, not in the form of financial support, but in the form of decision that this work should continue. So I have immense value for this, for a you know, this heartfelt region also, apart from the practical region, that because of your support many things happen here. So And one another thing that I see also is that when you feel to share anything about someone like this, those of you who contribute, it is something really very big actually, which we mostly don't notice. I mean, those of you who feel like this, you just share. You don't feel that it is something big at your end. And those who do not, are not able to see this also generally. What I'm trying to say is that it is like rising from limitedness or from possessiveness or you know, this attachment caused by sense of identity, sense of this being an individual self. And it creates a life and it holds it very tightly, you know, like my life, like this. My things, my money, you know, like this. And if you are able to share in that state something, I want to tell you it's something very, very powerful. It is already beautiful to participate in a meeting like this and to be open for it, but going one step further, you know, going one step further. I just want to let you know, beloveds, how wonderful it is. Like something opens up in you, you know. Your being is opening up beyond your limited self, I and my life, you know. I have very, very high regard for such a gesture. So all of you who support us like this, thank you so much for this. It is a automatic thing I found inside me many times, noticed that whenever anybody does anything like this to this group, this Sangha, to me, to anyone like this, a prayer arises inside me, you know. That Lord, I don't really have much which I can actually tangibly share, no? But if there is anything inside me beautiful, don't save it for me, let it be shared with everyone who moves their hand of love and support towards me. So thank you for this. And in the end, I want to thank actually all of you who participated in the retreats and who are participating in the open meetings also now. This thank you is for your openness. Because without openness, you cannot appreciate what cannot be understood by mind. Because this message cannot be understood by mind. Mind's whole functioning and capacity of understanding has evolved in most of the beings around the greed and the fear. Greed of having more and fear of losing. And because of that, it is very limited and prejudiced. And if you are touched by this sharing, it is already that you are going beyond that, growing beyond that limitation, and you have courage to start seeing life from your own eyes, not from the eyes of ego. Because it is a common occurrence when you come to a satsang like this that you may not feel like like, you know, staying even some time here because you just seems to not understand anything. But there is something inside you which says, no, I will stay. I want to stay. I want to see. And that is yourself beyond this limited persona of yourself. So I want to thank you all for this also. Thank you so much. In the satsang, there is no work going on. There are no opposites, there are no opponents. It is just one power. But as we mostly live in the limitedness of our mind, we perceive other parts of life as opposite to us, against us, and so on. And in the middle of that functioning and feelings, if you are able to stay in the meetings like this, I want to tell you, it's really amazing. So very, very nice. I'm very, very happy to meet every one of you. Don't feel defeated or sad if you are not able to understand certain things. It is not because you are not able to understand. It is because you are insisting to understand in the mind's way, in the intellectual way only. However, the deeper understanding is already taking place. And because of that, you are not able to give value to that deeper knowing. As you will see the power of mind and the limitation of it, you will start becoming more and more open to deeper knowing, which is always taking place. That would be sufficient. Even if somebody comes to the satsang and goes away, still they take something from here. But if you come and stay, you will definitely be so much benefited. Because satsangs are not private meetings, you know, facilitated or, you know, driven by a person. It is the decision of life. It is the highest tool God uses to bring us back to our natural, peaceful and always liberated state of the being. And in the personal state, we mostly mistakenly see these meetings as someone's meeting, someone's teaching, someone's message, you know, like that. If I could ever say the truth about these meetings, it would be a little bit like this. In this room, there is nobody else except you. You are with the light of truth, which is not insisting to teach you anything at all, which is not even trying to show you anything at all. And yet you will see much more. There is just nobody else here except you. What you can be afraid of? What you can get disturbed by? So this is what I would say if I'm allowed to speak the truth of these meetings. If you see this sharing going against your understanding or receptivity of this moment, can you look at it like this? I'm that part of you which you are ignoring for a long time, not hearing for a long time, trying to suppress the voice of that part of you. Can it be like this? And this is speaking only empowers that part which want to make itself free. From the long-lived habits, no? You feel you have a name, you feel you have a address and gender and like this. What if you just feel that you have all of these things sticked to you or imposed on you just because of living them for a long time in unconsciousness? As you start becoming more conscious, you will see more and more that I am not young or old. I am not male or female. I am not confused or clear. I am not sad or happy. All of these things are experiences happening to me. And somehow I take them as my experience and I put the responsibility of them on me. That I there must be some fault in me that I am having such an experience. What if you have never done anything? So presence of anything inside you makes no difference to the fact that you are already and always free. If you want to make yourself free, it is mainly because of this misunderstanding that whatever I am feeling right now or in my life in the past is a result of my doings and I must correct them. Your doings can be corrected as you see you are not the doer. Until then it will be more or less a superficial change that you can bring about in this ultimate view. The highest change that you can bring to your life is to see that you are not the doer of your actions. It does not mean that there is somebody else doer of the actions. There is something else, not somebody else. That something else is called existence, the wisdom of God. So it's not that you are not the doer, I am. Or I am not the doer, you are. No. There are no individual doers anywhere. And until this is seen, life is lived in a very limited version of the self, where confusions, struggle and suffering is the base experience on which all the other experiences happen. And we try to cover that base restlessness through the superficial experiences in one way or the other, like a drug, like a painkiller. That is the reason we seek happiness outside. Because of this misunderstanding that we want to cover this pain or this restlessness in the base. This is the best thing one can do to one's life, to see that I am not the doer, and to let your heart become free like this. Let yourself become free like this. And let us now come back to a little bit doing part about it. What can be done about it? Or can anything be done about it? Because there are different point of view about it by different teachers. In the ultimate sense, nothing can be done about it. Because this is the fact. That you are not the doer. If you are not the doer, how can you do anything about even not being a doer? But does it satisfy you? Does this message bring peace in you? If it does, it has done its job. Then truly you can say that nothing can be done about it. And nothing need to be done now. But until then, can we try to look if something can be done about it? I feel that something is seeing what is the case. Not trying to improve, not trying to lose anything, not trying to gain anything, but seeing what is the case. And somehow, the moment you develop this understanding and value for this seeing, that I want to see that even maybe I'm just bound for eternity, and even I'm not going to do, won't be able to do anything about it, but still I want to be sure about it. Because once you are sure about it, even that will bring peace, that okay, I am bound for eternity. Then you will stop fighting, you will start decorating this bondage then, makes sense. But the funny part is that anybody who looks into it finds something so different. So there is a doing which is not a doing really, that can help, that is seeing. And seeing cannot happen tomorrow. It cannot happen next week, next year, or next moment even. It can only happen right now. Because seeing is not a ultimately process. Seeing is a decision. Seeing is not an effort, it's a decision. Upon understanding that what is the value of it. So any one of you who feel attracted to this sharing and feel that decision that you want to see the truth of this moment, and if you feel that my help can enhance in this capacity of your seeing, you can take my help. I don't have any particular agenda or anything. I want to only help you see more, whatever you want to see, meaning the truth of this moment. Not the items of this moment, but your truth. What is your truth?
I also wrote my question down. Beloved Rajee, I think all my problems stem from caring what others think and whether or not I have their approval. Others' approval and love cause me a lot of stress and sometimes result in a lot of awkward behavior from me, and I'm afraid that I am unable to receive or give deep love. I want to be able to feel a very deep sense of love. I suppose it all starts from loving yourself first, and possibly as simple as just being present. But this seems very hard, and after being in the present moment, I can't help but to conduct postmortems of most situations. I get exhausted by my own mind and behavior. Sometimes fear and self-doubt paralyzes me, and I can't find the courage to do the things I wanted to grow, or be creative, or be present. I'm scared of not being able to cry or laugh from the belly like I used to. I want to feel fully, and I don't want to live a fake existence. Also, I am scared I ran from, ignored, or numbed many feelings growing up that I am now unable to retain information, memory, or sit still, though like this as a child too. Please guide me. What practical steps can I take before it's too late?
I feel the best thing you can do, and in fact everyone who is troubled in any form, is first of all stop. Stop trying to fix things. You know, begin right now. Not that you stop forever, but at least right now attempt this with me, that stop. Stop means that right now I'm not fixing anything. Because it seems like inside us we are on a project continuously to fix things, you know, to improve things, to change things. And for the valid reason, as per our understanding, if I don't change, I will not be happy, you know, like this. But so right now, you give up this idea. Meaning, do not support any activity or let's say any effort inside you in this direction, that I want to change or do. No, you stop. You just stop. Stay with me right now. And when you are here with me right now, not so much, you know, trying to fix things. You open up to an overview, have an overview. Bring everything in single light of your seeing right now. Single light means see everything at the same time. And if you see everything at the same time, you will not be able to focus on one thing or go deep in one thing. Because then you lose view of the other thing, like this. So, now you bring all of you, even if you want, you can read loudly or silently your own message. Just read it. It will come, your whole problem will come in this light right now. And let it be like this right now. This one light will enable you to see the relation between each other and their relative priority that you have to set, to fix, to change anything. And then you can have the best answer or conclusion that this is what I have to do. And the beautiful thing is that if you can do like this, you don't really have to fix anything. Like, you start seeing what is wrong. And as you see what is wrong, it starts going away. If you have to fix, you have not seen yet. For example, self-love. You said self-love. I don't really know what self-love is, because I have never looked into this concept or this process that is proposed by different beings. But generally, whoever I met, the self-love is an approach to suppress your turbulence state troubled state and try to cover it by something sweet and like this. Why you need to love yourself? When you are love itself. Meaning you are trying to give love to love. You are trying to give light to light. It can be valid, I am not saying it is invalid, but in this context of awakening, it doesn't really has much value. Another concept is acceptance. We try to accept. Why we need to accept anything? It is just a way to avoid seeing it. No? Why don't you simply see that it is there? If you see that you have a snake in your hand, then would you like to do this process of accepting that I have to accept that there is a snake in my hand, I have a snake in my hand, I have a snake in my hand, and then you will throw it? No, you will instantly, the moment you see, you will throw it. It's a question of life and death. Like, if I say, but you were not spiritual about it, you should have done this slowly, with awareness, you will say, are you crazy or something? I could have been dead actually, you know. You will not listen to anybody then. You will not follow any philosophies then, you know. In the same way, when you see what is killing you inside, what is your mistake, it just falls by itself. So like this, bring everything into this single light of your seeing. You don't move. You don't go anywhere. Everything will open up inside you, in front of you, you know. Do it right now and see what happens. Because for us here, everything is instant, right now. Bring everything. Everything that is inside you, bring, don't have fear. There will be no collision or anything like this. They will just come to a right perspective. Because when you look at one thing at a time, it becomes too loud. It is like listening to one of the two parties who are fighting to each other. Whenever you listen to the party A, it looks like the party A is the right party and whatever it is saying is the correct thing. And you become enemy of the party B. And when you listen to the party B, you feel, oh, party A is the culprit. Don't choose, only see. Do it now. Otherwise, how will you be benefited? So do it now for some time and then afterward you talk to me if you feel. In, I think it is in this book, Prophet, from Khalil Gibran, that he says that God gave us one cup of nectar in one hand, and he says, drink from it. And he gave one cup of poison on the other hand, and he said, don't drink from it. And since then we have been drinking from the poison and not drinking from the nectar. It is mainly because you don't see. When you see, you are drinking poison of the mind, you will not drink it. There is a normal, it is a common occurrence in the process of awakening, and many of you I am sure can understand, if not correlate directly, that at some point it becomes like poisonous to think in a personal manner. Personal manner, not trying to fix anything. No, personal manner becomes poisonous. And you just forget that whose fault it is that my life is not heaven. You feel this personal way is poisonous. Personal way of looking at things is poisonous. You kind of cannot take one more sip even. You just cease to flow in that manner. Because you can see. So here conceptual understanding will not do. You will have to really stay inside yourself in whatever is your state. And that will, some deeper understanding takes place here. And that is very quickly transformed into an inner decision for the change. And then change begins immediately. We don't really have to do so much hard work. In fact, no hard work has to be done anywhere for any fundamental change in your life, except see clearly. Anybody else want to talk to me? Yes, Ekta, you can talk just a moment. Yeah, we are ready.
Namaste, beloved.
You can put something under it.
Can you hear me clearly?
Yeah.
Thank you so much for the pointing and the guiding. For everything, basically. I just wanted to share that what you did for me was, all this time I was feeling, not now but before, that if I correct my state of mind, everything will be okay. But then you pointed to me, there is no state of mind to be corrected and you just need to stop. Since I've been, I can't even say I've been doing this, I've been sitting in satsang with you and things are just happening. And the rest that I'm feeling right now, I can't even express in words what I feel now. I just believe things are happening so much. Thank you so much for the simple pointing of just stopping and not trying to correct my state of mind. So I just wanted to bring this to you, that how much this has helped me. Thank you so much, beloved.
Thank you. It's very, very nice, no? That you understood this fundamental point. Normally we are blaming our mind for the troubles. Like in the spiritual context, it is a fashion to blame our mind, that it is my mind giving me so much trouble. Otherwise I would have been sitting in my samadhi forever. It takes me out and so on, you know. But it's not true really. The only thing which is causing all the trouble inside you is ignorance. And you are wearing that cloth of ignorance, of not seeing. And because of that you are just moving here and there and causing so much trouble to yourself. If you can just stop and only see, and just stop and only see and do nothing else inside you. All the mechanism of body-mind, which is so much troubled because of your strange movements and in the process of trying to fix things, they will just settle down by themselves and will become harmonious. But it seems that mostly people, we don't have so much patience. We want quick fixes. But this is the quickest. But it looks like if I don't do anything, how things will be fixed? And this is why we feel, no, it's going to take forever. It doesn't take really time, it takes patience. Patience is not really dependent on how much time has spent and still you are sitting in the Buddha posture and trying not to move. It is more about clarity, that this thing will work. I must really try it. You know, when you really understand the value of it and try it, it works like this. You know. Because just to start with, there is nothing inside you which can trouble you. Meaning there is nothing which can happen inside you which can trouble you. no movement inside you can trouble you actually. It is your relation with the movement that makes you feel troubled. Then you feel provoked to do something about it. Like this state is not a nice state, for example. This thought is not a nice thought, or having thoughts is not a nice thing. I should be free from thoughts, you know, like this. And thoughts are waiting for you. You settle in your peace, they disappear. Thoughts are our alternative existence. As your deeper knowing starts happening by itself, thought-based knowledge, knowing process starts slowing down and stops at some point. Nobody needs to remove thoughts, or nobody can remove thoughts from the mind. You know. So bringing in the light, or coming to the light source that you are, and staying here, rather than trying to fix the problems caused by the darkness. You know. In the darkness, there are nothing but your imaginations and your troubled state, which is caused by the imagination, that there is a ghost here. Now you are beating your own curtain and tearing off your own curtain, and in the morning you feel troubled that, oh, I don't know who did tear off this curtain in the night. Now the sun is coming to your eyes and you are not able to, you know, to rest or something. There was one, I don't know who told this story. There was one story I want to tell you. There was one man who was very troubled somehow, that he was a rich man, so he used to employ a gardener, like few gardeners, and working together like this in a very beautiful garden, and flowers are coming, you know, like this. And every now and then, every week or every fortnight, in the night somebody comes and destroys the whole garden, you know. And he really, you know, have been watching very closely in the night, sometime whole night just watching that if I just find this rascal, I'm going to kill, because he had gun and everything. But he did not find actually, and this thing is still continued, you know. And his love for garden was growing also so much like this. Then one day he said that better I ask my friends also, one or two friends. He had one friend, he said, you also come with me. Maybe I'm missing something, like is there a ghost or something? Like what exactly this thing? He said, okay. So his friend also, and they are just watching silently, because hiding themselves, no? Then this man felt a little dizzy. He said, I'm just going to make coffee inside the house. He said, okay. This man went, and then he went to sleep actually somehow. This man, the owner of this place. Then what his friend saw, now this man in the sleep came out with some, you know, something, some strong equipment or something, like, you know, what do you call this? Some plug or something for gardening, and he started destroying the whole garden. He could not believe that he himself in that sleep destroys the garden. And he stopped him and told him, see, what are you doing? And only then he realized that, hey, in the daytime I used to, you know, work so hard to make it beautiful, and then in the night I will just destroy it. Is this not our story also? In consciousness we try to beautify our life, and in unconsciousness we destroy these things, you know. Why don't we bring both together in one light? This is what I told you. Don't fix, they will fix themselves. When they unite, all will be fine. Then your actions will be unified actions, and you will not be doing rework, you know, rework. We are doing rework continuously. I do this and then undo this and undo this, like making mistakes, saying sorry and so on, you know, like this. You will have unified flow, which only grows, no coming back, no stepping back, you know, like this. I feel like this. So very nice that Ekta, you brought this here.
Thank you, Rajee. It was also something, you know, you gave me a new meaning of totality right now.
We are mostly living in this very limited state. Otherwise, whole life, and we don't know how much, what it means to have whole life. Whole life is yours, actually. I want to just quickly touch this totality, no? Did you say totality?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I mean, it is like this, that totality depends on the one who is talking about it, no? About its size or its believed in size, let's say, no? When we are living in the mind state, then our totality is also obviously very small totality, no? Totality of you, but it is not totality of life. You know? So is there any benefit of, you know, of being total in our actions? Actually there is. Like our mind is by very nature divided. It has been designed in such a way, it has evolved in such a way, everybody's mind, that it has to divide, evaluate and conclude. It is a processing, system. And if you can force yourself to be total, you will drop out of mind actually. Because you cannot be total and in the mind. You know, either you will be total or you will be in the mind. And drop out of mind into what? Into this. And this is in the infinite truth of life. Where you are, life is, and infinite possibilities are. And then, as you also said, that totality will be redefined again and again. It is the totality, this openness, this totality, which enables you to see that. That there are not really two people talking to each other right now when this question answer is going on. The totality of this conversation is that there is only this, no individual self. So it is a infinite possibilities in this direction. Whatever is shared in the words by those who experience them inside their heart is not only what they know and experience. There is so much more they know and experience which they cannot speak in words, which can be only indicated or, you know, lived together in the silence of this moment or in the togetherness, you can say. So you can imagine, you know, like this. So nice, nice, nice. There was somebody else.
Yes, yes. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Yes. Yes, first of all, namaste. This is Girish.
Hello, Girish. Nice to see you here.
It's a pleasure to be in your presence. It's a privilege and it's a joy. And I acknowledge this with thanks and with gratitude. First of all, you began this meeting with thanking everybody. But actually, we are the ones who need to thank you, because, you know, even if everybody else is there and if you are not there, there is no satsang, you see. So you are the satsang, actually, you see. So I have a couple of things that I want to discuss. First one is, you started the meeting by talking about paying attention to the present moment, kind of seeing the present moment, or exact words I don't remember. And I want to share my experience of doing that and take your guidance. What I find is when we try to look at the present moment, essentially we are keeping all the thoughts aside, and in a way looking and being tend to be kind of synonymous in that moment. So looking is not different from just being, and somehow things continue in that state. We tend to just be, nothing is there in that state. There's no push or pull or thoughts or future or past or anything. So in a way we can call it kind of an empty state. But it just continues to remain like that, or thoughts start to come back and bombard in a way, and then it is a lot of a struggle and effort to come back to that state of being or seeing, which are synonymous. So somehow there is a sense that things are not progressing beyond this. Is there something beyond this supposed to be happening? For example, like you say, the knowing of the light or knowing of the totality, or it is just the me that is empty, that is just being, and somehow almost there is a feeling of being stuck also in that place. So is this something that wrong I'm doing, or is there something that needs to be done, or just continue being in that state? If you could share a few words, please.
Yes. I mean, this is a good beginning, but it is definitely, there are much more possible here. The good beginning is to recognize, let's say, this movement, thisness, presence or present, whatever word we use, where we try to put our mind aside and focus only on this. You know, it is like this, but it's a effortful state. You know. It's an effortful state, and just a moment. Please come on.
Okay.
So this is an effortful state where what we are doing is that we are kind of trying to separate the essence from the transient. We are trying to separate the container from the content, like this, which is a valid attempt to begin with. So now first step has to be to appreciate this as much as you can. If you feel that there is nothing here, it is the mind saying that there is nothing here. So that has to be put aside also. And like this, so like putting aside everything, this is part one of it, coming to the purity of it. There is some purity of it, and which is so beautiful that once you touch this, you don't want to come to the mind actually. What to say of mind coming to you and troubling you? There is no such thing really. You don't want to come to the level where mind happens, because you get pulled, or kind of you are drowned into this beauty and this silence of this essence, this container in which everything happens, that you don't want to get out of it actually. Generally it is like this. And once it is achieved, once it is done, then second step is, which mostly happens by itself, that you kind of feel satisfied or content by living your own joy so much that it becomes clear to you that I'm never going to lose it. Then somehow this kind of, you know, aloofness towards the mind is broken, and some energy start coming to the mind, and as the energy comes to the mind, mind gets activated. So you can say, in a way, now you start seeing some content also in this container, in this emptiness. Now you will have to again understand the relation with the content, in this case you being the container. Because in the first step you have cleared the relationship with the container, that I am the container, I am the emptiness. Now you will set this relationship. What is my relation with what is happening inside me, the thoughts and feelings and everything? They are released also, and in this process you get to know what actually your relation is. And they contain some sense of identity also sometime, and they can catch you also. But ultimately what happens is, as the sense of identity is not so much present, and the settlement in your true nature, which is emptiness, is you know, happening more and more, and you are firmly rooted in it, a deeper knowledge happens here, which is beyond emptiness and beyond the knowledge of emptiness and everything else against or opposite of it. Then you know the real, the essence, everything is made of. And the real is not divided in emptiness or content, mind or thoughts, feelings or, you know, emotions, body or seer. It is, the essence is essence. Then here deeper knowledge actually begins. Or you can say true knowing begins here. Real knowledge, or I don't know how to say, true knowledge begins. So this is the whole thing. Now you tell me.
So that second part that you talked about, the transition to the real knowledge, if we may use those words, it's something what I don't find. So maybe I need to stabilize more and more in the container.
Yes.
Probably it is going to take time. Maybe tendencies are stronger. So but as long as I continue in the...
I feel that this is... maybe we are missing something mostly here. Like whenever I hear something like this from you, I would say that you are missing something here. Like you are trying, rather than trying to actually see the real emptiness inside you are trying to actually maintain some kind of emptiness inside you, which is basically a faculty and effort of mind only. You know, whenever you see real emptiness inside you, you don't feel like, wow, it's so nice. No, it is like as if you had a base inside you and it just flipped open, you know, inwardly. And you feel a bit disoriented actually, like, you know, like if you can correlate, like in the aeroplane when you have little bit like this, no? Like that kind of feeling even you may have, literally even sometimes. It's a very, like, it is a radically different thing when you experience. It's not like in continuation that I have been trying for 1 week and 1 month and kind of I'm settling slowly. It's not really like this at all. It is a mistake that we are making, I feel. There is no maintenance here. When you have found something most beautiful inside you, do you really need to keep focusing on it? No, you have to focus on finding the beautiful thing. Once you find, why would you like to go back to the pile of, you know, garbage? So I think we are not really, really touched by it yet. That's what I'm trying to say. Like, you have to really understand what exactly is this emptiness that we are talking about. So I can attempt again if you want.
Yes, I think you're right. Perhaps I have not really touched, and it's just a mechanical silence that I'm probably satisfied with, putting up with. So if you could share a few words on, after coming to that mechanical silence, or it's a state where seeing and being seem to be the same. There is no specific one thing seeing another. The seeing itself and being itself seem to be somehow synonymous at that place. But it is still, as you rightly said, it is more or less mechanical and mind manipulated by the mind, kind of a silence. And how does one break through or fall through that and get that collapse?
What is happening is that like what you are calling is not something very bad or not something like we cannot really say it is like mind. You can say has different layers. Mind has its own depths. You can say from very gross to very subtle, like this. So this probably is the subtlemost layer of mind, where seeing and being is just one. But still, it is mind. Meaning, it is the range of the mind where we are pulled back to the thinking. You can say like this. So it is like a boundary line. You are standing on a boundary line here.
Yes, it seems like that. Yes.
So what you can do is that even if you feel that there is just being, there is nothing to see here, still hold your ground. There is something to be seen here actually. And another thing that can help is satsang. In this state, satsang helps a lot actually. Like listening and trying to connect with what exactly is being shared helps a lot. Because you are in a good state, you can actually kind of see instantaneously the truth, rather than trying to convert it into some conceptual understanding, you know. So in this state, satsang and direct pointing helps a lot. Because you can actually understand. You are ready actually. Your also attention is turned inward, you know, that's what it means. It's just a matter of kind of highlighting some blind spot. Like there is a blind spot here, which can be actually highlighted. And once it is highlighted, like it is like once it is seen, it cannot be unseen actually, you know. So trying to see that with more and more is not valid really, I would say, in this case. Because once truth is seen, it cannot be unseen inside you. It becomes like if you understand this. I recently saw one video in which they said that what is a black hole? And if the whole of the earth has to be compressed into a black hole, it would be, the black hole will be of the size of a coin, you know, like this. Or if a black hole of the size of a coin comes, like happens or exists on earth, whole of the earth slowly will start, you know, being consumed by it. So this inside us is not a black hole, it is a white hole. You have created a hole into the thick and even sometimes invisible shell or transparent, you know, what you call shell maybe, of the ego by the grace of life, by the power of satsang actually. And that hole now will suck whole of the mind, and at some point the shell also will be like this, meaning not broke, will be broken, but somehow you will see that there is no shell really. So I feel this is important to understand what is recognition of truth and what is effort. Recognition of truth may require some effort, but recognition of truth itself is not effort really. And it leads to more and more effortlessness actually. It becomes like a white hole inside you and kind of does the same thing for the... It works like a black hole for the mind and white hole for you, the being, the light. You know, light comes out more and like... Let's say if mind is dark, called darkness, then it is consumed more and more like this. But it is much more an automatic process where you don't really have time to do sadhana, because you are just trying to handle the change that it brings in your life, which is too much actually, mostly too much. Like how to handle my normal life and so on, you know.
That stage yet, perhaps. Yes. But with your blessing and grace, I hope I transition very soon.
Yes. It is so very possible. Like for that, one has to really listen very carefully and silently, you know. Because in this silence, a sort of a shift happens. Actually, you know, you are actually able to see. You know?
Okay, I cannot wait to see. So.
When I'm saying listen, I don't mean that listen only a particular thing that I'm sharing. It is more like this satsang and speaking in satsang is more like silence talking or expressing itself more, you can say. You have to listen to the silence, and it is infectious somehow. As you are touched by the silence, you fall in your own silence somehow. In that, this recognition takes place actually, by itself. Nobody can do it actually. Really, nobody can do it. You can go to this limit where you are right now. That is the maximum possible limit where effort can take you. And you can notice, stay here for long. Because it is so effortful, you know. Like you feel out of breath actually, very soon.
Yeah, but sometimes there is also a feeling of kind of effortless being in that place sometimes.
So that's nice.
Sometimes
huh?
It feels.
So that's nice, enjoy that. It is nice.
Yeah, but it doesn't last for long. But not that I'm trying to stick to it also. I'm just reporting to you that sometimes it is not always effort. Sometimes there is this kind of an effortless relaxing into that state also happens sometimes.
So it is nice. Actually what happens is that mind also, the ego also somehow that you are, meaning that you are living as ego until you know yourself, that understands the value of it actually. Mind understands the value of it and it chooses to rest in it. But mind means separation from this silence. So mind can only stay here for some time and enjoy it, but cannot be it. If you want to be it, then, okay, just a moment. Yeah, you were right. Now the questionnaire is gone, so I should stop. There was some internet thing. So, are you with me still? Oh, no, I understand. This is because of this. Hello? Are you here now with me?
Yes, now I see your video. It was kind of stuck.
Oh, yes. There was some internet problem happened here again.
Okay. Yes, now I can hear you again.
Okay. So the in the mind state, by our effort and by the beauty and you know, light of satsang also, we are able to stay here for some time. That's the max you can do in a way, you can say. Like staying in this, in satsang is different actually, I feel. Because in satsang it is like this energy of satsang or togetherness of satsang does not really give anyone chance to understand anything or save anything if you are present here. You can be either present or save anything, you know.
Yes.
So if you are present, you start melting somehow, you know, in truth. But that is not what mostly people want. We want to get the truth. We don't want truth to get us like this. That's why we keep trying to get it, you know. Although it is not bad, but if you try too hard as a separate self, then you will stay as the separate self, even in the satsang, you know. It is more about listening and letting listening happen more, but not going to sleep, because whenever we try any such thing, sleep starts. Or one type of sleep or the other type, you know, like this. So no, not sleeping or not giving value to sleep, let's say. You cannot stay in silence inside you. But you at some point understand that I can dissolve in it. That is the right state, right attitude towards it, you can say. Because it becomes more beautiful than anything else. But it is not bad, it is really nice actually, what you are doing, like what is happening. But just try to understand what is what, you know, that's what I'm saying.
Yes, thank you. This will help me so much, you know, so that I don't get carried away by something. Now I can stay put with your words at your feet, of course.
Like,
one more quick point, is it okay?
Yeah.
Sorry, go on, please.
Like what happens is that in the ego state we achieve something peaceful like this and we think this is our ultimate state. In ego state there is no ultimate state really. In ego state everything is possessed or you can say owned by ego. And ego being the fundamental misunderstanding that I am separate from life. How much you can gain here? From the ultimate point of view, not much really. If you let go. Meaning, if you feel inclined to let go, then you have all of it without owning anything. Like you can say, like, that I don't know anything because I don't own anything, and yet I actually know everything instantaneously as necessary because I am not separate from the source of life anymore. So this is what I wanted to say.
Thank you so much. Just one more quick point, if it doesn't intrude into other people's questions.
Yeah.
To the previous speaker, you were mentioning about when the thoughts arise, looking at them. I don't remember the exact words. Looking at thoughts is one thing, but supposing, you know, it is a bodily reaction. Recently, I went through some extreme medical situations. At that time also, I was desperately trying to see if I could stay away. And, I think to the previous person, you said you don't have to do anything, watch them or something of that sort you were mentioning. But that seemed almost impossible when there are some bodily things going on, extreme conditions were going on. And it was in the middle of the night. There was no way I could have contacted a hospital or something. And at that time also, still I was trying to remember your words and Guruji's words and trying to distance myself from the happenings, but it somehow seemed almost impossible. Something had to be done, right? Some action had to be taken. So what does, staying apart really mean? Does it mean not taking actions or not being attached to those actions, or would the situation have itself resolved itself if I had not attached myself to it? Or some action obviously was called upon. So I don't know. I'm just asking now.
It's a very good question, actually. I feel it is a very good and valid question, that what it means to not do anything, no? Like, the thing is that we are, when we are here like this, in this question answer session, we are actually in the doer state. So all of our understanding capacity of the mind is doing only and only one thing, that it is trying to convert everything into an action point, whether for present time or for future. That, okay, what to do? Okay, so this is why there is so much importance of how-tos on the spiritual path, no? That this is a how-to, and like this. Whereas there is a deeper capacity inside us of understanding and knowing, if you can kind of try to holistically listen the answer of such a question or like this. This is why there is the importance of listening holistically in satsang. Then somehow at a deeper level you understand it. So when you are said that don't do anything about it is really not given to the doer. This message is not for the doer. Doer will anyway do. Doer is not like free to do or not do anything, Even the doer is not even free to not do anything, That, okay, I am a doer, sometime I will do and sometime I will not do anything. No. So your report is correct, actually, that when there is a problem inside, it is like a threat to the existence of this doer that we feel we are. It is not really a doer responding, it is body-mind responding, but you are living as body-mind, so you report that I respond, I move, I do things, it is appropriate. But can I attempt to share again that what it means to not do anything? It really means to not do anything. Meaning, whatever is happening is the way it is happening. Body is troubled and responses come from the body to solve the problem, to do anything, take help or do something on your own and like this. But it seems like there is a sense of incompletion inside the doer, which is the very architecture of the sense of doer, that it will feel incomplete always. Don't do anything about this. Let it be incomplete. Its incompletion will collapse it, will cause a dissolution of it. we try to fill this sense of incompletion by doing. This is where we are chasing our own tail. The more we do, the more we feel incomplete. Although on the surface we feel like reaching, finishing, you know, like this. This is the meaning of not doing anything. That don't attend this sense of incompletion in the from the attitude of a doer, but attend it with the attitude of living it. That live this sense of incompletion inside you. This is the answer actually. If you live this sense of lack inside you, only consciously live, not like fanatically that, oh my God, I'm missing this and that. No, not attaching the story to it. And only in the purity of this feeling of incompletion, live it. It is a door to completion, actually. And until you look into it, until you come here and live this, you will continuously try to do something which is not going to match the requirement here. So the answer is not what or how to do anything about this sense of incompletion inside. The answer is come here, sit in this sense of incompletion inside you. You are missing actually, that's all. It is like a piece of jigsaw where one piece is missing, and that one piece is you actually, not anything, not your doings, not your results. Just come sit in this sense of incompletion and you will feel like I was unnecessarily running here and there. Completion will be felt slowly, slowly by itself. So it is understood?
Yes.
We can only attempt.
Thank you so much.
I mean, I can only attempt.
Yes, please go.
You know, like in different times, we can only attempt this when you have a real urge for such a thing.
Thank you so much for sharing.
Thank you.
Thank you. Love you, Rajee.
Love you so much. Thank you. This thing that you cannot do anything to wake up, in one sense true actually, but in one sense also not entirely true. Like you can at least do something like, let's say, come to the satsang and try to listen what it means to not do anything, you know? And in that understanding, all of, as if you, the consciousness stops somehow, you know. You don't do it, it happens. It actually happens, you stop somehow. And understanding takes place, you know, actually, of what is what. Because what we are missing in this whole process of spiritual awakening is a blind spot, that is you. You are just not giving value to yourself and you are giving value to everything else. And whenever it is said that you, it is translated into whatever we take ourselves to be, obviously. But that's not what is you really. No. That is why listening helps actually, I feel. Listening kind of deepens in the sense that our sensitivity, capacity of, you know, understanding or knowing grows somehow slowly, slowly. Those who have patience can go for this option. Rest would like to try the doing approach. Only to know that this is not the answer. Like, even if you use common sense, how you can be free from the sense of doer by doing? Is it not common sense actually? I mean, and how mind rationalizes that sense of doer is just a sense inside me, which is like separate from me. I am going to do something about it. If sense of doer is just a sense inside you, why you are bothered about it? It's not just a sense. It is something much more than this. It is sense of responsibility also. Sense of making a right choice. Fear of making a wrong choice also. It's a big thing actually. So mind try to rationalize things. It is you, the wisdom of heart, which agrees somehow to whatever mind concludes that, okay, this is good enough for now. What if you don't agree to it? What if you kind of start evaluating the conclusions, not the thoughts. Don't evaluate thoughts, because that's what mind does. You evaluate the conclusions of the mind, that okay, this is your final answer, let me evaluate. Like you be the boss of this process called mind, no? That let me focus on what you have to give me, what is the answer? Mind says, this is my answer, okay. You feel, no, this is not really, it doesn't satisfy me. It doesn't give me what I want. You give this job to the mind, okay, find more. You stay as yourself, meaning as the presence, as the observer, that okay, let's see. Like this, mind will exhaust this energy also, and you will come to know that it cannot give you anything, you know, that you want. You want water, it can give you a thought of water only. When it becomes clear, you fall out of it, like this. Thinking about self is not tasting the self. Even thinking about tasting the self is not tasting the self. You know? And vice versa also true. Tasting the self does not require thinking that I am tasting the self right now. It's a real test and a very powerful one actually. And once you start tasting, you kind of feel drowned into it rather than struggling that how to stay in it. It is not a really, somehow I am not able to understand this so much, that how we can say, we feel like this, that how to stay in myself, no? Don't try to stay anywhere. Be just very, very clear about what you are and where you are, no? Because this is mind trick, that it tries to do things in one way or the other. Trying to stay as yourself is something very different than how we mostly understand. Yeah? Trying to stay as yourself is, you stop trying to stay as anything and anyone. But can you really do it? Maybe you can if you deeply understand what it means. Otherwise not. It simply means you stop supporting the thinking process, you stop supporting the sense of, you know, doer and doing and its outcome. Which will include the spiritual practices also, by the way. Because spiritual practices are also mostly done by sense of doer with the hope that it will bring some result, no? So, what is the answer? Be here right now. And this is not an effort, it is a decision out of this whole understanding, and maybe you have got bored also, like how many talks, you know, like this, that okay, it is much better to be just here, no? Than to understand this whole thing. It actually is true. It is much simpler to be just here right now than to try to understand this whole thing, you know. And then you kind of start opening up yourself. Then means right now, not tomorrow. So just be here right now, see what happens. And one thing also I want to say to you also, that what it means to be in the present is not like, okay, I'm in my emptiness right now. No. Don't try to be in your present. Try to be in present. In this which includes everything. Dare to open up. Which includes thinking also. There are thinking happening inside you, feelings happening, everything is happening. This is the truth of this moment. So being in present or being here means to encounter the truth of this moment. Encounter the truth of this moment, you will wake up from the from this delusion that this state can give you anything. Because dream is only able to hold you as long as you feel it can give you something. And as whole of you come here, you see, no, it doesn't give me anything. This is the meaning of being in the present. Meeting the truth of this moment. What is the truth of this moment? There is no emptiness here. Who said there will be emptiness? Who said to you that there will be emptiness here? It is not really meeting the truth of this moment. It is not being present. It is trying to be present spiritually. No. I'm not talking about that really. I'm saying really be present, not spiritually be present. You know, present means you cannot try to be present. You are already here. Like, would you, like if you had a sand or something, would you dig some hole and go deep in that? Like, how can you do that? You are already here. What it means is to appreciate what is the case. This is the meaning of being in the present. Appreciate what is the case. So what is the case? We are in this room. It doesn't look like so great. It's okay, this is the case. This is the case that it doesn't look like so great. But don't be quick in moving from here. This is the point, that don't move from here. Give more space for everything to be the way it is, and they will give you much more space for you to be what you are. It's a two-way process. It's a very fine give and take, you know. Happens by itself. You know. This is the meaning of being in the present. You can use simple things, you know, like this is in the present moment. Is it something spiritual? That is a spiritual towel. No, it's a very ordinary towel. So a ordinary towel is in the present moment, you know. So it means present moment is not essentially spiritual. It's ordinary, no? So like this. See this. What is this? Don't be lost in the details of it, that who made it and, you know, so on. But let your consciousness spread all over here right now. So don't focus on one thing only. If you focus on everything right now, you cannot focus on anything particularly. And you are very much appreciating, you are very much present here, no? This is the meaning of being present. Mind cannot be present and focusing on everything at the same time. It can only focus on one thing or one type of things. If you focus on everything, meaning don't focus on anything particularly right now, but also not that I don't care. No, you do care. You are trying to feel really everything as it actually is. You, the being, opens up here. Expand it. You start expanding here. This is the answer to the contracted state of ego. Being in the present. Doesn't matter what it feels like. Feeling also is in the present. Feeling is not the present. There are no feelings of present. That, oh, this feeling means I am in the present. No, feelings are in the present. Present being the container. Even the feeling of emptiness is in the present. Even the feeling that I am observing is in the present. Even the feeling that, you know, that everything is seen is in the present only. So value the present, not what is happening in the present. That's how it happens. Beginning by valuing what is happening in the present, then more giving the value to the container called present. No? It is not easy, but it is not difficult also, try to understand. If it is difficult, it is mainly because we are trying to to kind of overcome our habit of focusing on or not focusing on things. Because habitually we get stuck and we try to start focusing on things. You know? It is more like understanding deeper than the mind, and you can actually get it. Like, for example, if I ask you to just sit on this chair and do nothing, like looking like this and do nothing, how long you can do it? This is what I mean. I have been doing it for almost more than 1.5 hours, no? Can you do it? So there is an impulse inside us to move. This is ego model. And if you can overcome this, you fall out of it. Or you go into it and say that, okay, I had a very powerful experience of present moment today. Who had this experience? Like this. Okay, I think this is good. Since it is the last meeting, I would be okay if we can take one more question or something like this.
Namaste, Rajee. Very grateful for giving this opportunity and this invitation to be here. It's true, in this space I will try to ask a question which I had a confusion about, but truly it is an effort to bring this question up after being in your presence.
This is your presence actually, and this is the most difficult part of truth, that we learn only towards the end of life, end of this, you know, process of awakening. Actually, really, there is only one. That's what I said, no, yesterday, by the way. The truth is, actually truth is one. But somehow, we are not, like there is some energy inside us which is not opening up to it. And this energy is called ego, and we feel I am it. Actually, you are it and you are more than it also. So, when you open up, you lose as yourself and you gain as this, you know, like this, which is one actually. And somehow there is inside us, there is a sense, like a ripening happens over the period, that it's okay to open up, you know. Like inside you know somehow from intuitively inside that it's okay to open up, you know. Although it may feel like losing, but actually it feels nice also. Only as you let go more and more here inside yourself, you actually gain yourself, no? Like you become expanded basically. It's very nice, I feel. But try to ask if you feel it is important.
Yeah, I have to take myself in the past.
That's okay.
when I am with myself, being with myself, I can feel that I am in the present moment, and the work what I do, I am doing a project of promoting eco-friendly products, and sometimes I give sound healing and meditation sessions. So when I am there, I see I am a persona. Like, yes, I keep myself present that, yes, my work is here. This I try to always remember, keep it in my remembrance that is not my real work. My real work is here inside, which I always try to remember. But when I am in this persona and in this, when I interact with other people, so I sometimes feel I lose or I go somewhere else, or cunningness comes in. how to deal with this or be there.
I mean, if you want, like I feel that, or I would like to assume that you want a fundamental solution to it, not a superficial one, no? Fundamental is that don't do anything there, do everything here. Because you are as much there as less you are here. And you are as less there as much you are here. Meaning if you succeed in being present, you will start failing in being a person or cunning there. No? This is one and the same thing really. We don't have to deal with other things afterward. No? It's just one and the same thing. You just live your sweetness of the being. And even one may feel, and it is true also, that God will take care of that part, you know. Meaning the cleverness even is not required, in fact. Practical knowledge is required and you will apply that, live the practical life in the practical way. But even if you become clever and you feel it is cleverness, don't try to deal with that. Because trying to deal with that is like, again, falling in that same mistake. No, your time is very valuable now. Because you have started coming out of that model into your true nature. You spend more time here. Every second you spend here brings, in time, so much transformation at that level, which cannot be really compared. So I don't think we have to do anything about that, you know. And if that cunningness is felt inside you, and it is something which brings some uneasiness inside you, not some sort of incompatibility, let's say. It is for good only. Because living in the mind or mind way is a habit. And living as ourselves is our new discovery and decision. Habit will slowly go away. Nobody need to fight with the habit. Keep doing the right thing, wrong thing will stop happening by itself, you know. This is my feeling. Although I can say a lot about this if you want, but I think this is the best way, best thing I would like to say. You know? Because you are not two people really inside you. You are just one always. Sometime habit is able to pull you, sometime it is not able to pull you. It is almost like this, that as you start living in your presence, in your, let's say, simple work, or when you are on your own, not doing much, it is like light is kind of, sort of crystallizing, you know, it's like crystallizing in a way. Becoming more firm or conforming itself or something like this. At some point, it kind of saturates itself, that enough of this work, it kind of becomes free in itself and sort of on its own. Then it starts flowing out, you know. I think I can say like this, that there are two parts of awakening process. One is recognition and staying in that, recognition, living that. Another is revelation. That revelation is when this light or this energy comes out. Comes out means to the mind and the body level. And corrects. Like it is like that you woke up, you know. And you look around that, okay, I have been living like this. And you don't like many things, you know. But now you don't have to do anything. Meaning, you don't have the sense that I have to do anything or I can't do anything about it. Your look is enough, actually. Soon you will see these things are going away from your life. Your very presence is the answer to any confusion of the mind or anything which is not fine, not nice for you at the mind level, which takes time, you know. So that's why it is like an either-or situation that you are in your presence and happy and able to do small things. But when it comes to something very powerful or how to say, something too personal, let's say, meaning the opponent is speaking in a personal manner, then the ingrained faculty of the mind has to be employed to respond. And that is very strongly, you know, having the imprints of being a person. And that's where we kind of feel lost. It's okay, don't be in a hurry actually. This is my feeling. You see how you can. Okay. I think it's fine.
Thank you. One more small thing I will share.
Eh?
One more small thing I will share.
Can,
can I share one more small thing?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yes. Thank you. I understood what you said. So I just want to share my experience when I just arrived here and I was sitting there on the chair. So it was like I'm sitting outside the doctor's clinic where he's not going to check or do any x-ray of me, and the treatment is going to happen. And that surely happens here.
This is the magic of satsang, no? In satsang, work does not happen really. And those who think that some work is happening here is not true actually. It magic happens by itself, no, like this. And openness is all that is necessary. Because we mostly feel that, oh, you know, it is somebody telling me something and going to, you know, misguide me or something. No, no, it's not like this. You are really alone here, you know. If I can make you see this somehow, you will scream out of joy actually. Or maybe a little bit fear also that, oh my God, I am alone in this whole universe, you know. Somebody said this to you, said? Vikram said this. One of my student also said in Pune, no, that I'm feeling or I felt like as if I'm alone in this whole universe. You know, it feels a bit like this. But actually it is true, it's just you only here, alone. It's nice to hear. Thank you. I don't really have many great examples and things like this, or I don't like to use great words. I remember I go to this saloon, no? A hair cutting saloon, and I will ask for this man, my favorite, you know, guy who cuts, and if he's not there I will wait for 1 week, 2 week, even some time, you know. But there are other people also who can, in an emergency, they can cut your hair also like this. And when you go to a hospital also, like, you know the specialist, you know, there is a specialist and he's not there, and then there is assistant doctor or something like this, you can say, junior doctor. You feel it is urgent, so at least let me attend, like let me be attended by him, and you know, like this, you take the prescription and you reluctantly, like this. I feel in the meeting like this. The silence actually is the main doctor, who does not speak anything to anyone, and yet its message is louder than any other words that are spoken here. But if we don't understand. Sometimes we don't understand actually the value because of our habit also. Like silence is not going to discuss with you that, okay, this is your problem. No, he is a senior doctor, no? Senior doctor just comes and writes quickly two, three things and just go home, you know. Doesn't have a whole day for you, you know. That, okay doctor, I want to begin from the morning. I ate this and then this happened. You'll say, you talk to John, junior doctor, you know, like. So the silence is the most, the teacher here actually. Those who cannot understand this language of silence, then speaking also happens, which is in service to the silence only. But the real thing is this silence, you know. And I'm happy that you are able to connect with this. So it's very nice, thank you. Then we can end this meeting, I think. A good time.
Rajee, I want to talk to you.
Pavitra, yes, please talk.
Yes. Thank you so much, Rajee. When I not in front of you, but I feel that around me, I just wanted to get rid of my thoughts. I want to get rid of my. Please, कहते हैं कि मेरे ये गर्भ भरा मस्तक मेरा हरी चरणों में झुकने दे. इतना ही मेरा है कि मुझे भी मेरा भी हाथ पकड़ के मुझे भी सही रास्ता दिखा दो राजी. मैं इतना ही चाहती
हूँ. You just stay in the satsang, nothing else is required, no?
Yes, that is. Thank you so much to help me.
But when I say really, stay, I mean really stay.
Yes.
You know, stay and not thinking.
To,
you know?
There is nothing to worry. I'm always there. And I'm really get absolutely thoughtless when I'm here with you. I'm so thankful to you.
One thing you must remember, in fact, everybody can appreciate this if you want, that it is not a meditation room where you are doing meditation on your own and you have to be afraid of your thoughts and anything. No, here nothing need, you don't need to be afraid of anything. You can allow, you know, you can allow everything to be here, and in the light of truth you will be able to see what it is. And like this you will become free.
I'm totally free when I am with you. I'm totally free. Yes, yes. I'm very thankful to you, really. I'm very thankful to Ekta. She gave me that. Show me the way to come. It's the Guru's charnam is very difficult. I'm lucky one. I'm blessed one. Thank you so much. Mm-hmm.
It's nice.
बस इतनी मेरी अच्छी उन्नति है कि मुझे भी हाथ पकड़ के मेरे भी मन के पार जाने की होनी चाहिए. बड़ी कोशिश करती हूँ पर मैं फिर मन में आ जाती.
I feel you stay sufficient amount of time here in satsang, that is more than enough.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Just be more and more available, like, you know, listening. Just listening is actually all that is necessary. Because what is shared here is words and silence. What your mind can understand, will understand. And what your mind cannot understand, your heart understands. It receives, you know. So it is like you are drinking light. And you are, when you are receiving this silence and this talk, you are like drinking light, no? And you are habitual of living in the darkness of mind. I am kind of spoiling you in a way. This satsang is spoiling you, no? For mind. And you cannot be happy with the mind anymore if you start drinking this light of truth, you know. It not only shows you what is what, not only you kind of feel more uncomfortable in the ego, but also it gives you courage to go beyond yourself, actually. This is what is most fundamental work that happens in satsang, that by itself, that you come and you just drink the light of truth and somehow you are able to remember that I am this. That day you are actually free, even if it takes time after that. That day you have actually become free. It is a process to remind you, not to create you, not to destroy you, not to do anything. This remembering is called waking up, actually. Once you remember, you will not forget. So have patience, just continue like this. There are no fast ways to wake up, really. We all think like this, that can there be a faster way than this? Like, you know, fast way to, like a course called Fast Way to Awakening and like this. No, actually it's not like this. So have patience. Like a very simple thing I want to say in the end, that if you cannot drink the light of satsang, do you think you will be able to handle the light of your heart which will arise from yourself by some quick fix, by some, you know, shortcut? I don't think so. if you can handle the light of this satsang, then without any effort, your heart opens up, the light of your heart opens up and meets the light of this moment, of this truth. And like this, you know we are not two, actually. We are one. Actually, we are one. So, very nice, thank you. Then I think it is very, very good time to end this meeting. One more time, thank you so much, everyone. It was wonderful. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I say goodbye to you, online friends. We meet again, hopefully. Thank you.